Good morning. Welcome to everyone. You've joined the Food Justice Learning Webinar this month about coffee. Welcome. Each month on the second Monday of the month at noon Eastern Time, we are having these learning calls hosted by the Food Justice Fellows of the Presbyterian Hunger Program and Presbyterian Hunger Program. And today we've got three presenters to talk about three different models of food. If you have questions during the presentation, you can type them into your question window and we will try to get to them. The format of the day is to go have each of them introduce the three different models, Equal Exchange, Café Justo, and Think Coffee, briefly with a couple minutes, and then to go back and do some more in-depth conversation about how the model works throughout kind of the coffee chain from the community producer level on up and what kind of impact it has on communities around the world. So, did want to briefly introduce Bryce, Wiebe, and he is here at the Presbyterian Hunger Program. He is the new associate for Enough for Everyone, and I will just let him introduce himself once I can find his screen and unmute him. All right, there we go.
Hi there. I'm Bryce Wiebe. I'm the new associate for Enough for Everyone. It's a ministry of lifestyle integrity here at the Presbyterian Center. One of the things that I do is manage our relationship with Equal Exchange and a few other fair trade partners in administering the Presbyterian Coffee Project, where we seek to connect congregations and individuals to a more just way of purchasing their morning joe. So we encourage people to consider the way they shop and the things they buy and evaluate them based on how they're produced and how the people at the start of that chain, of that supply chain, are considered and taken care of in the process of getting coffee to its end users. So with that, we've assembled a few different models. Again, Equal Exchange, whom we work with as our primary partner with the Presbyterian Hunger Project, and the Presbyterian Coffee Program, sorry, and Café Justo, who is a vendor for our global marketplace. When we have large events, they come and sell to other Presbyterians, and they have some Presbyterian connections. And then Think Coffee, which is a more direct supply sort of model, and that will be shared with us by a Food Justice Fellow who's worked with us the past year.
All so right.
With that, I'll give it back to Andrew.
Thanks, Bryce. And so, yeah, first we will hear from Rodney North, who joins us from Equal Exchange in Boston. And I will just give me a second to pass the screen over to him. And as you all, if any of you have done webinars, know if this works, it will be wonderful. Expect it to not work, but enjoy the miracle if all this works.
Hi, everybody. This is Rodney. I have two screens in front of me. Bryce, could you tell me, are you looking only at my sort of gray opening slide?
Yes.
Okay, you don't see anything blue, like with 1,000 icons on it?
No.
Great. That's my other monitor. Okay, so very quickly, as I understand it, this first part should be about the American side of the supply chain, what you call sort of the retailer-consumer experience of it all.
Yes.
So on our first slide, you'll see it says the Equal Exchange Fair Trade Co-op to Co-op model. I would emphasize that we believe in economic justice for everybody involved. So we ourselves are a democratically organized a worker-owned and governed cooperative. And we work with farmer co-ops, hence co-op-to-co-op model. We are a full-service coffee roaster and fair trade wholesaler. We operate nationwide. We have a variety of products. It's not just coffee. We also work with tea, sugar, hot cocoa, chocolates, healthy snacks, also crafts. Really everything you might need regarding fair trade, we provide. We provide a whole variety. Let's talk about coffee. A whole variety of fair trade coffee products. Whole bean, drip grind, coffee for percolators, which are popular in congregations. There's 100 different products. There's packaged coffee, cans, individual pillow packs for offices and institutional use, the bulk coffee. And one reason we have everything people might need is that we know this is what it takes to facilitate greater use of fair trade. So we take away all of the little nagging hurdles, like we provide coffee equipment, brewing equipment, filters, cups. We really don't want people to have to go elsewhere to get these things. We're, like I said, a full-service operation. So besides working with grocery stores or cafes, as you might expect, we work with congregations around the country, small and large religious offices, conference centers. We have a fair trade fundraising program for schools. And also we have a online website or web store for individual households who want to buy the fair trade products that we're bringing in. And besides working with PCUSA and the Hunger Project, we've been endorsed by 11 other faith-based groups for the same reasons that the Presbyterians have endorsed us, because of this coincidence of values that we're all pulling in the same direction. And so these other groups are also helping us get the word out to their faith-based communities. And lastly, we've just have set up everything that people might need, whether it's a 24-hour option of ordering online, wholesale pricing, a dedicated customer service team, but also out of all the sales, 15 cents of every pound of product, every pound of product generates a 15-cent donation to the PCUSA Hunger Program. So I will leave it there for now. Hello.
Hello, everyone. My name is Adrian Gonzalez. I was born and raised in Agua Prieta, Sonora, right in the border with Arizona. And I've been working for Café Justo for over 10 years now. And Café Justo is a coffee grower cooperative based in four states in Mexico, where we market pure organic coffee, which is grown and harvested and marketed in the spirit of justice. And our goal is to provide incentives for people to remain on their family lands. Our business model is simple and optimize the profit for growers. The coffee is harvested, cleaned, and prepared for shipping in one of the communities located in Chiapas. Then the beans are transported to the border here in Agua Prieta, Sonora, where we do the rest of the processing, which is roasting, packaging, exporting, we have at least one customer in every state now, and also a few customers in Canada as well. Our customers are pretty much all denominations, churches participating, but we also have our retreat centers, coffee shops, farmers market, restaurants, and hotels. So the idea behind Just Coffee is pretty much that the growers own every aspect of the business. So in this way, all the revenues goes back to the co-op, where it can be where they can use it for pay for the processing, and also the revenues goes more in detail to provide benefits to growers such as healthcare, social security, and a retirement plan. And we've been doing this for almost 12 years now, and thanks be to God. We have received a huge support from the Presbyterian Church almost since the beginning, and it's because of a loan provided by a ministry named Frontera de Cristo, and also by another program that self-development of people that we started up on our feet. And, well, 12 years later, here we are, still growing and still hopeful to educate and change the way people buy things. And so pretty much to have a justice for everyone in every level here. So again, this is my name is Adrian Gonzalez, and I'll be sharing with you a little bit more in detail later on. So back to Andrew.
I can't hear.
There's no sound.
Oh, shh.
Really? Apologies for that. We lost the audio, so we will give that another try right now. Thanks for your patience. All right. Hopefully you have visual. Now let's see if we can get some audio.
Hi, my name is Emily Piper. I'm representing Think Coffee, the cafe with 5 locations in New York City. Several years ago, Think began sending its employees to independently verify the claims of our roasters and third-party certifying bodies, as well as to develop relationships and partnerships with producers. Several Think employees identified the need for values and ethics-based importing, and they started a company called the Bushwick Seed Company. It's a small importer that writes community-identified projects into its importing contracts. They actually bought their first shipping container of coffee from Ethiopia last year. The first project was between Think, the Bushwick Seed Company, and our exporting partner, Nardos Coffee, in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. I went to Ethiopia for December and January to oversee the building of a library for a primary school in the producing community of Kalensos in southern Ethiopia. As part of this project, I also worked with the women teachers and leaders in the school to purchase products for female students so that they could attend school during their periods. We ended up buying washable, reusable sanitary pads that were distributed in March. Think sells its coffee to its customers and to roasters all across America, and each roasting sample comes with the pictures and videos that I took in Ethiopia to tell the story of the coffee so that consumers can see the impact of their purchases. I was also lucky enough to travel with PCUSA and Equal Exchange on the Fair Trade delegation to Nicaragua 2 years ago, so I'm happy to be part of this presentation.
All right, excellent. So we will go ahead and circle back around to Equal Exchange and hear from Rodney about kind of a production and value chain of the coffee and also to talk a little bit about the impact on the producers and families and their community. All right. There we go.
Hi, everybody. I'm going to wait until you can see my screen.
All right.
Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you. So this graphic is a good representation of what we're trying to do. On the top bar is the way we work, small farmers coming together in cooperatives, selling directly to us. We in turn sell to, here it says store or cafe, but in that place you could also place office or congregation. And for those sales, that's actually the end of the line. There is no consumer, so there's only four links. And as we've found with many commodities, not just coffee, but cacao and elsewhere, what's much more common is what you see down below, which is now increasingly common knowledge, that we have these very extended, attenuated supply chains with many, many people and entities between the small farmer and the coffee drinker. And so we helped to pioneer in North America the concept of disintermediation and shortening the supply chain. We knew that one of the problems was not just that farmers were paid too little, but okay, why are they paid little? Often it's that they're too disconnected from the end user, often too invisible from the end user. And so we thought by shortening it, A, we could help to set new terms, which would be more beneficial for the farmer cooperatives, but also in these shorter supply chains, help get these stories back to the American coffee industry, back to American coffee drinkers, knowing that when the stories get through, then people will begin to care and make more responsible choices. One thing that we're that's key to what we do is who we work with. We do not work with large-scale plantations. We believe that they're a vestige of so many forces that have skewed the economies in the global south to the disadvantage of regular people. So instead, we work with democratic cooperatives of small-scale farmers. And we've been buying from coffee farmer co-ops for 25 years now. We believe that when farmers control their own businesses, they're going to be in a much better position to advocate for themselves. There is the adage, don't give somebody a fish, teach them to fish and they'll live, eat for a lifetime. We know that there's no need to teach farmers how to farm. We just need to stop stealing their coffee. In essence, so many of the conventional market forces encourage importers to buy low and sell high, to pay as little as possible to the small farmer. And so we're trying to change that dynamic, just to trade fairly, to trade as equals with the farmer co-ops, and by being a friendly buyer to them. And that takes, and it's not just, oh, by the way, I wanted to mention that besides working with the 25 coffee farmer cooperatives, we work with about another 50 different farmer co-ops around the world. This slide you're looking at, the brown dots represent the coffee cooperatives we work with around the world. So you'll see on four continents, overwhelmingly from Latin America. So what about fair trade? What's best known about it is the pricing model. Currently, the commodity market, the world commodity market price for Arabica coffee is only about $1.15 a pound. We abide by a fair trade certification standard run by small farmer co-ops themselves. It's called the SPP. In Spanish, it's the Símbolo de Productores Pequeños, or small producer symbol. And under that system, the minimum price is at least $2.20 a pound. And of course, sometimes we're paying more than $2.20 a pound. And it's not just the price, a higher price, but the fact that it's a stable one, enabling farmers and farmer co-ops to do more long-term planning and to remove some of the unpredictability, economic unpredictability, which is always detrimental for economic development. We've been working with some farmer cooperatives now for 15 or more years. And when we do initiate a relationship, we stick with it as long as imaginably possible. If there's any quality control issues, we work with the farmer co-ops to turn that around, not only so that we're getting high-quality coffee, but so that they have a robust quality program and have better sales across the board, including to other buyers. Other components of fair trade include the provision of affordable credit. This was something that we helped to pioneer in the American coffee industry way back in 95, so over 18, about 18 years ago, where we will pay for the coffee, sometimes months in advance, and making this pre-financing available at an affordable rate. You can imagine that in farming communities, you have an annual crop like coffee that's essentially one paycheck a year, and it's hard to stretch that up for the next 12 months. So in the months leading up to the coffee harvest, this is when last year's money has run out, that we make sure to make this credit affordable to the 25 farmer co-ops that we work with. And there's the direct long-term relationships I was talking about. And there are those quality control relationships, which is just one manifestation of the relationship, but it's a critical one. Our director of purchasing and our quality control manager, together, they probably are logging something like 50, 60,000 miles a year, traveling around the world, visiting with the farmer co-ops, doing cupping sessions. It's a kind of quality training to help the staff, the quality control staff, improve the quality of their coffee, which is going to help them be a strong business as a farmer, as a coffee exporter. It'll put them in a stronger position for the long term. And many of our partners have won awards as being some of the best exporters in their country. And this is even in competition with the very well-financed large plantations. That slide was showing how we supported organic farming. Probably about 90 to 95% of the coffee we buy is certified organic. We pay extra for that. One reason is that there are huge environmental benefits from organic farming. And in these mountainous regions like this is the Andes in southern Peru, this kind of polyculture, small-scale farm, which resembles the native forest, is much more resilient. It actually provides higher quality coffee and susceptible to things like this. This previously was a non-sustainable farm before Hurricane Stan hit this region of Nicaragua. It did not look like, it did not look like that. It was a monoculture field, which now is just wasteland. So I'm running long here, so I'll quickly wrap it up. So our goals are to trade fairly as equals, to support the capacity and independence of the small farmer co-ops. Ideally, if we were to be gone, the farmer co-op partners would be in better position than they were before, to build markets for the farmers, to bring the fair trade idea to new consumers, not just coffee drinkers, but to tea drinkers, people who eat bananas, who eat chocolate, you name it. We want the benefits of fair trade to be brought to other farmers and other farmer communities. We want other businesses to adopt a fair trade model. So we bring the model into the banana industry, we bring it into the chocolate industry. And then, as we are doing right now, we want to be an advocate for the farmers and for food justice in general. And when the farmers aren't here to tell the story themselves, for us to help speak on their behalf and advocate for practices that would serve them in the long term, and give them a chance to make a fair livelihood from their farming. And I'll leave it there.
Thanks so much. That's great. And we will jump to Agua Prieto in Mexico. And let's make sure that Adrian is off mute. There we go. Go ahead, Adrian.
Excellent. Can you hear my, can you see my screen now?
Yes, yes, we see the slide.
Excellent. Here. Excellent. So I'll start now then. Thank you. Okay, as I mentioned to you before, I'm Adrian Gonzalez, working for Café Justo. And so I'll go briefly through the slides to tell you and share with you more in detail about what Café Justo is all about. And the entire focus of the startup is to develop a self-sustainable international coffee exporting business. And this is pretty much to create opportunity jobs here in Mexico and in the communities in Mexico. And the Café Justo cooperative, as I mentioned before, was started with a loan from Frontera de Cristo, which is a binational ministry of the Presbyterian Church. And we also receive a grant from the self-development of people to start up. And something that is really, that I really like about the co-ops is that the participation of the members is not limited to any particular religious belief or parties or gender in the community. So it's really very inclusive, which is something that sometimes we are not, and especially in rural areas, we are not too focused on. And it's sometimes it's really divided the communities because of the religious beliefs and the politicals and you name it. So this is a great way for people to come together and work together as a one. So this slide is a Café Justo basic information. We were founded in 2002. We have four cooperatives in Mexico, two in Chiapas, one in Veracruz, and one more in Nayarit, which is the newest one. We have a warehouse processing facilities in Chiapas, and also here in the border where I live, we have the roasting and the packaging facilities. We have 7 employees in Agua Prieta and 3 in Chiapas. We help started 2 cooperatives in Haiti, and also in partnership with another Presbyterian ministry named Living Waters for the World, we have installed 3 water purification systems in Chiapas. So the coffee is a single origin coffee, meaning that it is all from the same geographic location in each state, and this guarantees the consistency and flavor. This means that it's the same families cultivating in the same land from generations to generations. And it's an organic coffee, especially in these areas, it receives a lot of rain per year. And it's a shade ground coffee. We don't use any chemicals, pesticides, or herbicides, or anything that affects the environment. In fact, it's one of the best response for global warming. It is my understanding that cultivating coffee is a great answer for that. It is a fresh roasted coffee. We always have the most recent crop for our customers, and we roast the coffee until the customer orders. So in this way, you can receive the most fresh coffee cup in the morning. This is kind of like the way we operate. We call it it's a vertical integration. As Rodney mentioned it to you before, the traditional coffee has all these steps that you can see in the right. And with Café Justo, we have the grower is part of the co-op, and then the co-op, it becomes the buyer, the processor, the roaster, packager, exporter, and broker. And the number 3 will be the congregations, all the customers that I mentioned it to you before, such churches, restaurants, hotels. So that would be there are only 3 steps in this model, whereas other traditional models can have up to 10 or 12 steps before getting from the grower to the coffee drinker. And with this model, we guarantee that there is no middleman, and the growers control pretty much most of the processing in the chain. So this is the cooperative processing. The key principles is that consensus decision making, democratic run. We have a board of directors with a president, treasurer, and secretary. It is financial transparency. This means that every member can come and ask the board where the money is going, how much money is spending in each processing. And also this is we extend this for customers as well. It is a sustainable social business, and it is totally organic, and we'll use, again, no chemicals to grow the coffee. And any of the this is one of the requirements to anyone who wants to be part of Café Justo, is that they don't use any, that the coffee is organic, they don't use any chemicals, and also that they own the land they're cultivating in. So this is kind of like the Café Justo path. As you can see, in all these stars represents co-ops that are in Mexico. As you can see, there are two co-ops in Chiapas. There is one co-op right here in the Gulf of Mexico in the state of Veracruz. And the state of Veracruz co-op, they're the ones that are providing the decaf for customers. We have another co-op, the new one is in the other side of in Nayarit, the state of Nayarit. And all the coffee comes from these areas to the border, to our Prieto Sonora in the border, where the coffee is, again, roasting it and packaging, and then exported to their customers in the United States. So this is our graph and some numbers about how much percent of the money goes to each of the process for you to see. The average price for partners, you know, partners are churches, hotels, I mean, anyone who has a partnership with us, we call it a partner. And the average price for them is $8.50 per pound. So out of that $8.50 per pound, 29% goes for green beans coffee payment for the growers. That would be something around $2.45 per, just for the beans, for the green beans. Then 32% of goes for the coffee processing that is being done here in the border in Agua Prieta, the roasting, the packaging, the exporting. 12% is to cover the processing that is being done in Chiapas or in the co-ops, which is the retria, the cleaning, and also shipping the coffee from these states all the way to here in the border. 80% of that goes for salaries and benefits. This is for employees and growers. 6% goes for investment in new equipment, and 3% goes for the Just Trade Center. Just Trade Center is another, it's a ministry of the Presbyterian Church of the Binational Ministry of Frontera de Cristo, that is their entirely goal is to educate and people about how Café Justo works, what are the difference between buying Folgers and fair trade coffee. These are rounded figures. Just
Adrian?
You to know. Uh-huh.
Hey, if I could just jump in for a real quick question. I'm curious uh-huh. about the 29% paid for the green beans to the grower.
Uh-huh.
And then down below, you have 18% for salaries, benefits for employees and growers.
Mm-hmm.
Is beyond the price paid for the green beans, are the growers also receiving some kind of salary or benefits?
Yes. Something I'm going to discuss a little bit in another slide, but no. Let me go ahead right now. 29% of the green beans coffee payment goes directly to the grower's pocket. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. That's for paying for the beans. But also, since we do everything in Mexico, and all the revenues goes back to the co-op, we can provide benefits for employees and growers, such as healthcare, social security, and a retirement plan. This is in addition to what the grower is being paid for the coffee.
Wow. Okay. That's.
And also, as Rodney mentioned it to you, it is true. You know, the growers, most of the time, growers receive just one check per year.
Mm-hmm.
We call it coffee payment here because we have a payment plan for the growers, where we deposit every week money so they can pay, you know, themselves. So this guarantees that they will have money from one crop through the another crop. You understand what I'm saying? So
yes.
Okay. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm moving on to the second to the another slide. So this is the benefits that we can see of the Café Justo model, is that we address the root causes of migration, and we know that the root causes of migration are usually economical. We use the vertical integration model, again, all the revenues stays in Mexico, and we can create more opportunity jobs here in Mexico and bring more farmers to be part of the co-ops. We call it a fair trade and direct trade, because we do, us, the growers and the employees, do direct trade with the coffee consumers. It is a delicious coffee, direct to the customers. We have never received a bad comment about how the coffee tastes. We have always received really, really good comments about the taste of the coffee. It's famous, this coffee, for being really low in acidity. And it is, again, because it is organic, it is fresh. It is a coffee that comes from the always from the same states in Mexico. And when, since we do everything in Mexico, we can provide benefits, as again, healthcare, social security, and a retirement plan that covers the growers, but also the employees of this co-op. This is the major accomplishment that we can, that are tangible, and we can see is that, you know, it's always great to receive a call from a coffee grower and say, you know, I'm so happy that that my children are back in the community, and that I don't need to employ them to help me in the coffee field, but I can send them back to school. You know, people return into the community. We have, again, installed systems to purify water in the communities. We are working with 4 coffee cooperatives under the same model, and they all send their coffee to the border here, where we do the roasting, the packaging, and the exporting. There are over 100 families getting benefits from this model directly. And the processing and the roasting facilities in Chiapas and Agua Prieta are totally owned by the co-ops. And we have great relationships between growers, employees, and customers, and the coffee is excellent. The thing about Café Justo is that we want to create a fair relationship between the coffee grower and the coffee drinker, wherever they are, is to create a bridge between, you know, between them without the need of a middleman. I wanted to use this moment to invite you to participate in the border-to-border trip. We are so pleased that Ruth from the Hunger Program and also Bryce are joining us for the one that is happening in a month, in November 2013. But we would like you to come and see what Café Justo has been doing here in the border, but also in the co-op and the communities where the co-ops are located. So you can come and meet them and share ideas and see what they are doing and see what they think about how this have helped them to improve their lives.
Excellent. Thanks. Thanks so much, Adrian.
And no, thank you.
We will go ahead and hear from Emily. And hopefully this will work right off.
Matt Fury from Think met Dawit Daniel and Akalulu Kasa Nardos several years ago. Akalulu was the son of Kasa, the most powerful elder in the village of Colenso. Akalulu got into the exporting business because coffee was basically the lifeline of the village, and he was extremely successful with exporting. He now lives in Addis, but runs processing and collection plants all over southern Ethiopia. Matt wanted better coffee and connections to growers. Dawit was a devout man who wanted to use coffee to make the lives better for the people of Ethiopia. And Akalulu wanted to improve the village he grew up in and the village that gave him so much success. Dawit had the idea for Matt to import coffee himself because I spent 6 weeks in Ethiopia working with Elias, superintendent, and Tulu, principal, making sure that the building came together. We used local materials and contractors and laborers, which was actually a bit of a challenge because I went during coffee harvest season, wrong time to go. All of the people that would usually be looking for work were able to harvest coffee and make a lot more money doing that. So hunting down workers was a daily activity. Each of the parties, each of the three partners, contributed money toward the $7,000 budget. And I even got a fancy private school in Addis Ababa that was the school for children of diplomats to donate old books totaling about 137. And we're hoping computers and even volunteer teachers are will come out of that relationship. Original plan for the girls was a device called the Ruby Cup, which was unacceptable due to opinions on virginity. I found an organization called Days for Girls International that makes reusable, washable, absorbent pads, which Zinash, who was the teacher in charge of the girls club at the school, was really excited about those. I trained her in how to use them because they were going to arrive after I left, and they were distributed with much fan excitement in March.
All right, just a sec. There's the thing.
So these are two images I created to give us a closer look at the value capture for different kinds of purchasing models. The image on the left is an extrapolation of the value capture for this, for Think's type of relationship purchase. So in eBay, about roughly 20 cents per pound would be paid to harvesters bringing fresh berries into the processing plant. And then $2.85 would be paid to the exporters in country. The importer might then sell it for about $3.20 to roasters. And then you could buy it in a cafe for maybe about $14 a pound for direct trade. Now in Ethiopia, 20 cents a pound, the price paid to harvesters. This will buy nearly 2 pounds of kale, or sorry, 2 pounds of lentils, or about 2 bundles of kale. And then if we look at the image on the right, that's based on a study I looked at on conventional coffee in Uganda. So on this side, 7 cents a pound would be paid to the harvesters. 24 cents a pound would be paid to exporters. And then importers would sell that for about 75 cents a pound to roasters or distributors or other retailers. And then you would go into a grocery store and you could buy this for maybe about $9 a pound in the store. Now, $7 a pound, the price paid to the harvesters, the workers, this is less than a fifth of the price for 1 kilo of maize flour. As you can see, roasting is the greatest value add, so it retains the greatest portion of the markup from, you know, bean to cup. However, considering many conventional coffee suppliers do the importing and the roasting, this is a lot of consolidation of the value capture in a conventional model. Additionally, in our direct trade model, a much greater portion of the profit would remain in country, depending on the types of negotiations between exporter and roaster.
All right. Yeah, I think now would be a good time to jump to a couple questions. And if Bryce could go ahead and ask our live panelists those. And if you have a question for any of the presenters, please type that into your questions window for us, or raise your hand. But we'll start out with just a couple questions for Adrian and for Rodney.
All right. I think I'd like to ask perhaps the second question that our presenters have seen from us first, and that is where the fair trade and or ethically sourced coffee movement, where you might see that heading in the future. Rodney, you want to take a stab at that first?
Hold on. We'll get all of our panelists unmuted. There you go, Rodney.
Hello? Yes. Can people hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
I'll be quick. So we've been watching this for 27 years now since we got started. And we see very clear path or trajectory, which is for the continued growth of both fair trade and other types of, quote, ethically sourced coffees. one thing we have seen, and we're sure that we'll continue to see it, is the increasing participation of conventional companies. So these are companies not like Café Justo or Equal Exchange. These are conventional companies that, for a variety of reasons, they may do some fair trade or other ethical sourcing, but not entirely. And they'll be, and this is true in all kinds of industries and all kinds of reform movements, there'll be some products will be marketed and it'll look like a fair trade or ethical product, but maybe not so much. Maybe it'll be abiding by a lower standard. And we're gonna see all of that and all of that increasing, what you might call fair trade light, and also an increase in the real deal. You know, people like Café Justo and Equal Exchange and other fair traders, that's where we see it going. But also an increasing interest by the consumers, coffee drinkers, an increasing interest by retailers who want to stock these things. So the general direction is good.
Good. Adrian, to you.
Well, it is my understanding that the fair trade movement have been here for over 60 years. And I think we are growing slowly, but steady. I think that we are entering a time of greater growth, but we're still insignificant in terms of families affected and market impact compared to the big fish, you know, that control the world trade in coffee. But it is great to have companies like Equal Exchange and many others that are, you know, creating awareness and educating people about the difference between, you know, supporting big companies and small farmers. So it is my hope, however, that the success of these models continue to grow and educate more people. And it eventually will affect the big players, you know, and so we can share the market and you know be much bigger.
All right. Actually, we've got a number of questions from some of you on the line, and I wanted to start with one from Phyllis Rose for Adrian, just because it's a really kind of practical one, and she asks, Your coffee comes to us at the height of freshness, sweetness, and flavor, but sits around in our church too long and gets stale. How can we better store it?
Well, how can you better store it? Well, you would like to put the coffee in a not too hot environment, you know, like in a cabinet or so, or you can put it in the freezer without not opening. But once that you open it, don't put it back, because you know coffee is gonna absorb all of the odors that exist in your refrigerator. So for us, I think that coffee that is ground, since it's roast and is to, it would be great for you to sell it as fast as possible and to use it as fast as possible. Ground coffee should last in a good taste easily 4 months, and the beans fashion should be at least 7 months. But again, I can drink a bag of coffee within a week. So try to drink it or sell it as fast as possible. That would be my recommendation.
All right, thanks. And we've got a real quick question from for Rodney. And then we'll go to a question from Lucas. But the question is from Lauren Ornelis, and she wanted to clarify whether Equal Exchange uses fair trade flow or another or U.S. or is this small producer something different?
We've used a number of different certifications for coffee. We are currently switching almost everything to what's called the SPP, Símbolo de Productores Pequeños, which is a fair trade certification created by the CLAC, which is a Latin American network of fair trade certified farmer co-ops. So this is helping the farmers take control of fair trade certification. For our non-Latin American coffees, that will still be certified by a Swiss group called IMO. So there's that, and you can read about all of that on our website. You can, at the search tool, just type in SPP, and you'll get the answers. But also, regarding the freshness issue, I was going to remind people, basically, buy as much as you need, but no more. Don't open the bag until you have to. Buy whole beans if you can, and then grind it only when you're about to serve it. And then also keep it away from light and air. Ziploc bags can be helpful. And on our website, there are brewing tips. And there's tips about buying and preparing and storing coffee to help people with these questions.
Great. Thanks. And yeah, from Lucas Oswald, we have a question. How are farmers held to sustainable production standards? And is it the responsibility of the buyers or the co-ops to regulate this? Adrian, do you want to go first?
Sure. I think both. But would you say the standards of quality, you say?
No, the sustainable production standards.
Oh, I think both, again, because, you know, you should demand, when you buy a product, you should demand transparency, you should demand that the product is organic and it was fair, paid a fair price for it. So the more as you, a consumer, care about all these, you know, issues, the more pressure you will put in co-ops to offer you a better product.
And in Café Justo, Adrian, how is this actually regulated? How do you know that the coffee is produced sustainably or organically?
Well, you know, the co-ops have their own how can you call it, committees, to ensure that this is happening, and they go and visit the coffee plants and talk to the coffee co-op members to be sure that they are continue to do this, and so they are controlling this, and also since you need to renew your organic certification every couple years, you must be doing it the way they ask you, otherwise you will lose the certification, because if one of your members is not doing what the requirements are for the organic certification, then the whole co-op suffer.
Right.
May I weigh in?
Yes, please.
So I believe it sounds like Equal Exchange's farmer partners are operating the same way as Café Justo, and it's a practice that's known as a group certification. And so you have a farmer cooperative, it may have 100 or 500 members, and certification means that there are external auditors that could be coming from Mexico City or Caracas or Brussels, and they're not going to visit all 100 or all 500 farmers. So rather, they are randomly going to visit 10% of the farms in the cooperative to make sure they're abiding by good organic practices, not using synthetic pesticides. But the cooperative also needs to demonstrate to the auditor that they have a system to keep everybody on the up and up, a system to make sure that all the members in the cooperative are abiding by organic practices, and that the cooperative has a way of, for example, segregating organically grown beans from conventionally grown beans. So the farmers are sort of on a random basis are visited and tested. The coffee farmer cooperative, their offices, their paperwork, their warehouses are visited and inspected. Likewise, the roasting operation here at Equal Exchange, everything we do with the beans has to be verified by the organic auditors, and all of our paperwork has to be checked. So that's how it goes.
Great. And we've got a question from Mark Hare, who I believe is right now in the Dominican Republic, doing agroforestry training with folks down there. But his question is about the fair trade coffee market. Is it affecting the global prices of coffee? And where are those prices right now compared to you know, a few years back we had a crash. I think prices are up again. But yeah, how does that play out in the wider marketplace? And along with that, if we could ask, if you know it, what percentage of all the coffee traded is fair trade certified?
I can give a quick answer to both of those. Starting with the last question first, currently only about 5% of the world's coffee exports are sold on fair trade terms. However, the farmer co-ops who are growing that, they're actually exporting three times as much. So they're only exporting a third of their harvest on fair trade terms. Mm. The other two-thirds, they sell on conventional terms. And in terms of fair trade affecting overall global prices, I would say that it is not. If you're in a farming community, let's say a valley in Peru, and there's a farmer cooperative and it's selling to the fair trade market, there can be a local impact. Because the co-op is getting better prices from its fair trade buyers, it's offering better prices to local farmers, that can have an upward effect upon the coffee prices paid in and around that valley. Now, but because on a global basis, only one bean out of 20 is bought on a fair trade basis, that's too little to influence the price of the other 19 beans, the other 95%. And as you were alluding to, we had a terrible collapse in coffee prices roughly from 1999 to 2002, 2003, 2004. Later in the decade, coffee prices started to go up. They started to go up very quickly in 2009, 10, and 11. They really peaked at nearly $3 a pound in 2011, and they've been going back down again ever since.